Welcome to Module 6 on Planar Rigid Body Kinematics. So this module is analogous to the module number 2, which was about kinematics of particles. So in that particular module, we regarded physical objects as particles where all the mass of a physical object was concentrated at one point. And then we could only talk about its motion in a plane or in a space, which could be given via a trajectory. The kinematic quantities of interest were the position, displacement, velocity, and acceleration. In this module, we will be talking about the kinematics of physical objects which are going to be assumed to be rigid bodies. In reality, physical objects could deform as they move through the space, but for the purpose of this module, we will consider them to be rigid body. So the first question is, what is rigid body assumption? Rigid body assumption says that if you have a physical object, then if you pick any two points on this object, the distance between these two points, let's say it's R, does not change. So R is constant. And this will be true for any two points you pick on the object, not necessarily two specific points. So if I pick another two points, let's say C and D, then the distance between C and D, let's say that's R prime, is also constant. And that's the rigid body assumption. Distance between the two points does not change as the rigid body moves. So when can we make this kind of assumption? You can make this assumption when you are looking for the motion of an object, where a rigid body assumption would give you the answers that you're looking for. So in reality, the physical object may actually deform. So take, for example, an aircraft. When an aircraft moves through the air, then its wings could deform because of the pressure from the wing, pressure from the air. But you could still regard them as rigid bodies for the purpose of the calculation that you're going to make. So it all depends on what kind of model will give you the fidelity that will give you the answers that you're looking for. So if the answers you're looking for are the deformation of the wings of the aircraft, then of course a rigid body assumption would not work. Okay, so it all depends on what is your final goal and whether a particular kind of model will give you the answers you're looking for. So in this module, in fact, in this entire class, we will not be looking at things that can deform as they move. So rigid body assumption would be the assumption that you'll be making from this point onward. So we'll discuss the kinematics of particles, we'll discuss the kinetics of particles. Now we're going to be talking about rigid bodies entirely. Okay, so that takes care of the rigid body part of this module, right? Kinematics says that we are interested in geometric motion, and the quantities of interest in this module would be the velocity and acceleration. Okay. The planar part of this module says that we are going to be studying the motion of rigid bodies that move in a plane. Now, that is not necessarily to say that rigid body itself has to be a planar object, like a thin lamina. The rigid bodies could actually be true three-dimensional rigid bodies, but the only constraint that we're going to impose is that every point of that three-dimensional rigid body is going to move in parallel planes. So take, for example, this plane. In this plane, I have this disk. It doesn't have to be a disk-like shape. It could be anything. And this disk is actually allowed to move in this plane. So let's look at a very simple motion. So let's say this disk is actually rotating with some angular velocity about an axis that could be passing through its center of mass, but it doesn't have to be. Every point on this disk, whether it's in the same plane or not, is moving in this plane, right? So you could make multiple slices of this object, right? All these slices, every point in these slices is moving in parallel planes. So if you look at velocity of a point over here, maybe it's this way, okay? Right underneath in the next slice, the velocity would still be in the same direction, although it is in a, that particular point is in a different plane. So every velocity is in parallel plane. And that's what we mean by planar motion. So in this case, the disc may look like a planar lamina, but I could actually take a top that may be rotating. And now this clearly looks like a three-dimensional rigid body. As long as this axis of rotation is fixed, then every point in this rigid body is moving in parallel planes. If this axis begins to oscillate, this axis of rotation begins to oscillate, then of course it won't be a planar motion. Because then, after a while, let's say this is the new position of the top, then this particular point may be moving in a different plane altogether. Okay, so planar motion says that all the velocities and acceleration would be in parallel planes. And we can pick any reference plane we want to. Okay, so that essentially dissects the title of this module, Planar Rigid Body Kinematics. We are going to be modeling our physical objects as rigid bodies, where the distance between two points would not change. We are going to be talking about the kinematics, which is concerned with the velocity and acceleration of a rigid body. And we are going to be concerned only with the planar motion. So at this point, you may be wondering as to how many velocity and acceleration quantities we would need to describe the motion of a rigid body. Okay, because a rigid body is an object, and it has, by definition, maybe multiple points, if that's how you want to model it. You can model it as a discrete particle, you can model it as a continuum, and every point possibly may have a different velocity and a different acceleration. So does it mean that we have to describe the velocity and acceleration of infinitely many points? Well, it turns out that because of the rigid body assumption, that problem is highly simplified. We need only very few quantities to describe the motion of a rigid body moving in a plane. So how many quantities that is? To understand that, we have to understand a concept, the concept of degree of freedom. Okay, if you have more than one degree, then we will say it's degrees of freedom, right? If it's just one, then it'll be this degree of freedom. So what is degrees of freedom? Degrees of freedom basically tells you how many independent parameters you will need to describe something in a unique way. Okay, so that representation should not be a redundant one, because you can always, you know, use more parameters than necessary to describe a position or a state of a particle or a rigid body or a system. Okay, so what we're looking for are minimum number of independent parameters. So let's write that. Minimum number of independent parameters that will describe the state of a system uniquely. Okay, so let's talk about a point in a plane. Okay, so I have a point P, and this is my plane, and let's say this is my, you know, XY plane, all right? How many independent parameters do you need to describe the position of this particle? You would say it needs only two, let's say X and Y, right? So at this particular instant, you know, you just need two parameters to describe its position, okay? If this particle was located in a three-dimensional space, it will need three parameters. So that's X-axis, Y-axis, and Z-axis. So two parameters, three parameters. And these numbers, two and three, are nothing but the degrees of freedom of this point, right? Okay, now let's talk about a rigid body. So we have a rigid body, and since we are only concerned with planar motion, so we'll just have a plane shown over here. How many parameters are needed to locate this rigid body in a plane? Okay, so this is how we can do it. We can pick any reference point on this object, you know, and for simplicity, let's say we assume that we're going to pick its center of mass. So we can locate the center of mass of this rigid body, and we could say that we could position this rigid body in the XY plane by looking at its center of mass, right? So that would essentially just position it. But at this particular position, the rigid body could have multiple states, right? So for example, I can have this rigid body rotated about center of mass, and that would be a different state, even though the center of mass has not moved, right? So clearly, we need the orientation also to describe the position of this rigid body. So we need x and y, which will locate one point on the rigid body, but we also need its orientation. So how would you describe the orientation? Well, we can attach another reference frame. Let's call it x prime and y prime. And if this x prime, y prime is rotated with respect to the OXY, this frame, which you can call, let's say, fixed frame, then the orientation of x prime axis with respect to x might give you the orientation, right? It doesn't have to be that particular angle. It could be an angle made by y prime with respect to y, but it doesn't matter what you pick, right? So if you have a reference axis with respect to that, you can show the change in orientation of this rigid body. So let me draw this again. This is OXY, and this rigid body is, let's say, positioned like this, and there is a frame attached to this rigid body, and X prime with respect to this X axis, this is the X axis, horizontal, is at an angle theta. And the coordinates of O prime are, let's say, X and Y. So how many numbers did we need to describe the state of this rigid body in a plane? We needed X and Y, and we need theta. X, Y, and theta. And those are three independent parameters. So what we're concluding is that we need three independent parameters to locate a rigid body in a plane, which also tells you that degree of freedom of a rigid body in a plane is actually three. Now, if we extend this to three-dimensional space, so imagine this is a rigid body moving in a 3D space. So here is my rigid body in a three-dimensional space, okay? So it's actually a three-dimensional rigid body, or x, y, z. How many parameters are needed to locate and orient this rigid body in a 3D space? First of all, we need to pick one reference point, right? And that would be described by three numbers, x, y, z, let's say. And then we are going to need three angles also, okay? And, you know, choice of angles is pretty arbitrary, but we will definitely need three angles to describe the orientations. So it could be oriented on an angle with respect to x-axis, angle with respect to y-axis, angle with respect to z-axis. So we will need three angles. Let's call them alpha, beta, and gamma, okay? So altogether, we have six numbers. So degree of freedom of a rigid body moving in a three-dimensional space is actually six, right? But this is not of concern to us in this module. This is what we are interested in, right? Motion of a rigid body in a plane. And we just saw that we need only three numbers, which are xy, which is the position of a hard point on a rigid body, and the orientation with respect to some reference frame. So this might also tell you that maybe we can give the velocity and acceleration as perhaps the derivatives of these variables. Derivative of x and derivative of y would give you the velocity of the reference point. Derivative of theta would give you the rate at which this rigid body is rotating. If you take one more derivative of theta, you will get the sort of angular acceleration of this rigid body. If you take second derivative of x and y, you will get acceleration of the reference point, right? So this is kind of telling you that we are not going to be needing infinite number of velocity and acceleration description to tell you something about the motion of the rigid body in a plane.